Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the India track of FFT's Global Capital Summit. My name is Ratnesh Mittal, and I'm going to talk to you today about sales strategies for startups. Let me share my screen. To start with, a bit about myself. So I've been a corporate veteran of more than 25 years, spent almost all of my career in enterprise business management, sales being a large part of it, and generally responsible for revenues and bottom line. Prior to my corporate career, I did my MBA from XLR Jamshedpur. I've been to a few management schools post that to keep myself updated on what's happening in management leadership. You can see my LinkedIn contacts, email address, etc. on the screen, and feel free to reach out to me or connect with me later on. So before we get on to this, onto the part about sales strategies, let's look at what do startups talk about the most? What is it that you really focus on? And one of the things that a lot of founders talk a lot about, and it's really the more glamorous part of being an entrepreneur, is about innovation, is about technology, products, and of course, funding. The more mundane aspects of business operations and sales seems to sometimes get treated as general skills, stuff that is not really a big differentiator. But obviously, that's not really true. And if I was to look at what do the large, successful technology companies do, many of you will be surprised to know that big companies such as IBM, Microsoft, spend much more on their sales and marketing than they spend even on research and development. So these are technology giants known for their innovative capabilities, but they spend significant part of their budgets on ensuring that they're doing the right things and reaching out to customers. Big businesses therefore recognize the specialization that is contained in acquiring and retaining customers. And that really is the genesis of really why we focus on ensuring that there are specialized skills and special ways of looking at sales and marketing, especially for enterprise customers, but any startup for that matter. So the question for us for the day today really is, how do you succeed in the marketplace? And my proposition to you is that this question further entails you to answer at least three or four other fundamental questions. And the first one is that, what really is your strategic sales objective? What is it that you want to achieve through your sales team? Other than, of course, the fact that you want to achieve revenue growth, but really, what's the strategic objective? What customer segments are we targeting? Do these segments naturally select themselves for your business, or is there a science to it? Having defined your sales or business strategy and your customer segments, then what really is your customer engagement plan? How do you plan to go about doing that? And if you've answered all of those three really more strategic questions, then the last bit to really and the key to successful selling, as we will see later on, is how good is your execution plan, and what is a good execution plan? What does it take to have a good execution plan? So let's start with the first one, and it's really competitive advantage, which to a large extent defines what your sales objectives are. During this presentation, I'm going to use a few 2x2 matrices to illustrate my point. So the point I'm trying to make here is that at a generic level, competitive advantage or strategies really consist of a variation of two broad themes. You're either a differentiated strategy, you've got differentiation and you're really pitching yourself on the basis of your innovation, or you're a cost leader. You've been able to find a way of doing things at costs far lower than current incumbent players are. So you're a cost advantage, cost leader, or you're an innovation leader. That's what I've got here on my x-axis and on the y-axis. Remember, on the y-axis, lower cost advantage is on the higher side, and if you've got a high cost advantage, you're here. So this gives us a neat four boxes kind of a matrix to illustrate our point. Obviously, real life is not as simple as four choices, but I'm doing this more to highlight the point. So for example, if you are in a business which are, or yours is a company where you've been able to find a really high innovation in your area of work, and therefore you can really differentiate, However, the cost of this innovation is not low. So you don't have much of a cost advantage. You've been able to build that innovation, but not really a big cost advantage. Then your objective from a marketing and sales point of view really is to position yourselves as a premium player. What this will entail from a sales strategy point of view is that you will therefore look at deep customer engagements, which a lot of which will be customized, bespoke, a lot of frills on services and other things, because you know you are kind of somehow battling the fact that your cost advantage is not there. Somebody else is cheaper than you, and you've got a high innovation advantage, which can only be demonstrated through deep engagements to bespoke creations. On the other hand, if your innovation is not really very very good, but you've been able to do things at a cost far lower than what other operators in the market are able to do, then your task from a sales team's point of view is cut out to really replacing incumbents. You're not really going out and pitching a new way of doing things to customers as much as addressing their need to optimize on their costs. And therefore, your sales plan and sales strategy will be oriented towards identifying weaker competitors and going after winning market share from them. On the other hand, if you are in this great position of having a high innovation capability as well as a high cost advantage, then you want to ensure that before other people catch up with you, either on the innovation side or on the cost advantage side, you rapidly scale up and you establish your lead. So your sales team's tasks are going to be cut out from point of view of scaling, reaching out to customers, and quickly establishing that market lead. Needless to say, just to cover the fourth box, if you're in this, so to speak, unfortunate position where you're neither really differentiating much, nor do you have much of a cost advantage, then you're really looking at a small market. You will need to eventually move to one of the other three boxes. But while you remain at this place, you will look for niche areas, places where other people are not able to fill the gap or don't find it attractive enough to be able to offer their products or solutions to those customers. So that would kind of define what is your sales orientation towards. Are you looking at positioning yourself as a premium player? Are you looking at scaling up and establishing lead? Or are you really looking at market share gain to a cost advantage? The next bit is segment selection. Now, it's far more complicated than most people really pay attention to. Very often, businesses end up going after either no segment selection, which means that you address everybody in the same fashion, which is a disaster because then you end up wasting a lot of your resources and not really targeting sharply and fulfilling the requirements of any one segment. But I think that's less likely if you are a startup, especially if you've been around for some time and you've gone through maybe one or two or three rounds of funding, then it's unlikely that you are being everything for everybody. But the other pitfall is that very often people end up segmenting on bases which are good to execute, but not really the sharpest from a point of view of guaranteeing success. For example, if you are segmenting yourself on the basis of, let's say, geography of your clients or on the basis of type of customers, you will definitely do better than not segmenting. But the more interesting values and leverage comes if you are, for example, segmenting yourself on the basis of how different types of customers buy their products and services. How complex is their buying process? One of the telcos I used to work for earlier segmented their customers on the basis of the buying complexity. So for example, there was a set of customers whose buyer behavior was much more simpler, and therefore the sales objectives there was to scale, sales cycles were shorter, and the sales team was oriented towards ensuring that they did not spend a lot of time in internal processes, but were agile in responding to customers. Vis-a-vis another segment where the buying process was lengthy because the customers went through detailed evaluations and as well as did a whole lot of work at a pre-sales level before they really decided to go ahead and buy services. So this is just a representation of the kind of possibilities you may have. But like I said earlier, segment selection is a complex exercise and it is best done in the context of your industry, your business, and the problems that you're trying to solve. Which moves us to the third aspect of of the strategic questions we want to answer, which is what really is your customer engagement model? And very often, a lot of startups and businesses have reasonable clarity on their business models, have reasonable clarity on the customer segments. But very often, because of the lack of specialized focus on sales, end up getting the customer engagement model not so right. And what do I mean by this? So let me look at another 2x2 matrix. And here I've chosen a simple metric of looking at saying that if I'm trying to engage with customers, I've got two fundamental parameters which help me decide how I should be going about doing it. The first one of them is really how many products and solutions do I have? If you are a company which has been able to build, let's say, some kind of an end-to-end value chain of solutions that your customers can buy versus a single product company or a single solution company, that's what I would represent to you here. Few solutions, few products versus many products. And for the chosen segment, and now this model needs to be applied to each of the segments that we spoke about in the previous slide. So if you are, for example, addressing three different segments of your business in three different ways, then you may need to have three different customer engagement models. At least you need to ensure that you're taking a decision on evaluating customer engagement models for each of those segments separately. So this is a sex of, in that segment, how many customers, potential customers, can you really address? Is it a tight segment with a few players? Then you are at this end of the line. Or is it a segment which has many players? In the example I gave earlier, for example, that segment was consisted, you know, the segment where decision-making was faster consisted of a lot of customers. So clearly you would fall here. Now, based on your matrix of number of solutions and products that you're selling and the number of customers that you're selling this to, your sales engagement model kind of presents itself. For example, if you are a company which has a lot of solutions, either across genres or in the same line of business, but across the value chain, and you also happen to be in a market which has a reasonably large number of customers to address, then, for example, you will at some point of time, earlier than later, you might need to consider structuring your sales team in such a fashion that you've got hunters and farmers. And this is particularly true for startups. Why do I say this true for startups? Because as a startup, you are also in the business, or you are at the stage where you're rapidly adding new customers and customer acquisition to your portfolio. If you go for example, an account management strategy, which means that if you are tempted to follow a strategy, which a lot of established companies in your businesses might be doing, which is that they've got, you know, a set of account managers who handle those accounts and are also responsible for adding new logos, you will find pretty soon that the moment you have existing customers for your given set of salespeople, 80-90% of the time gets consumed in only servicing those customers. And that slows down your pace of acquiring new customers. And therefore, I often recommend a hunting, farming, separation approach to startups which fall into this grid, to say that have a specialized team whose job is to keep going and acquiring new logos and handing them over to your account management farming team, which will really go and ensure that there is multiple product penetration which happens in those accounts. If on the other hand, you are not somebody who's got too many products, you've got a limited set of offerings, but you still have a lot of customers, then the easier way to ramp up, and the hunting farming strategy requires a lot more on the roads kind of sales teams. But if you don't have too many products, then a faster strategy to kind of ramp up presence in the market is to leverage other people. And other people would include channel partners. Other would also include a lot more strategic alliances for selling, which are known as sell through or sell with alliances. If you're a technology company and for example, we work with a startup which is in the area of Industry 4.0 solutions. So they've got some fantastic solutions, but focused in the area of Industry 4.0, essentially two or three products which are really their mainstays. Now, one of the things that we're doing for them is that we're helping them align with some of the larger system integrators, some global players who may also have an Industry 4.0 or a manufacturing practice, but they can't cover everything on their own. But using the leverage of working with those system integrators, they're able to open up doors into markets which would otherwise have been very difficult for a startup to reach out. If you are somebody who's got a good value chain, but relatively fewer customers to manage, then you are fine to take a key account management approach. You know, you'll have a few high quality salespeople whose job will be to kind of go deep into those organizations, build relationships across the buying chain, ensure that they understand the business of the customer so well that they can have a conversation with any leader of any function in that business, because they know that, you know, you can make a difference to the value of that customer, make a difference to that customer by adding value across the value chain. On the other hand, if you've got fewer products and you operate in a market which is also constrained, doesn't have too many players, and you got a single solution. So for example, if you are a Boeing, you're a aircraft manufacturer, you will typically fall into that bracket. How would a Boeing sell? Yeah. So you will clearly sell by some very high powered selling, the co-founders themselves, maybe your advisory board, maybe some really high powered industry resources who can help you connect with the CEO or the C-suite at your customer locations would be your way of selling. You would clearly, this is the antithesis of a channel sales or an account management sale. So that's really what your customer engagement model would look at. While, you know, these are a few important and critical questions to answer from a strategy point of view, ultimately good sales management is all about execution. I'm going to leave you with a very simple framework, which according to me defines what successful sales execution will look like. And I believe good execution sales rests on three pillars. A lot of people really typically focus on just one of the pillars very often, and that's the people pillar. But I think before the people pillar, you've got to look at the leadership and processes pillars as well. Leadership, in the general sense, can never be underestimated. But when it comes to sales, it is a different kind of a sales leader that you want if you're looking at scaling up your enterprise. And in the context of leadership in sales, what sales leaders are often tasked to do is that, for example, what are the traits and behaviors that sales leaders will demonstrate? Other than good leadership behaviors, specifically from a sales functionality point of view, sales leaders will set a lot of goals. They will set shorter milestones. They will set output goals as well as input goals. They will create initiatives which will ensure that the smaller input goals are met first and that the right things are done so that the right outputs will start coming. Sales leaders will drive programs relentlessly with focus and consistently. And that requires a great deal of energy, focus, and of course, knowledge about sales practices. Quite a few other things, which of course leaders pick up as they go, and maybe specific to your environment, also specific to the context of the larger organization. But leadership is a big pillar which determines, to my mind, about 60 to 70% of your sales success. The other big pillar is processes. And often companies create sales processes which are determined through their internal mechanisms rather than the customer's buying processes. So the key to getting the right process is that your sales processes must mirror customers' buying processes. If you are able to do things which customers are expecting in their buying journey, and if you are kind of two steps ahead of the customers, you will find that you're typically higher on win rates, higher on deal sizes, faster on sales velocity, and so on and so forth. A lot of the process per portion also involves ensuring that your reviews are fair and there is a great deal of data-driven selling, which is quite popular these days. And data-driven selling does not necessarily mean getting salespeople to provide data, which is then used to just beat them up, which is another one of my favorite topics, but for some other time. Last but not the least on the pillars, people. I mean, it's pretty obvious having the right kind of people for the jobs that your strategy determines them to do. I have consciously put tools in the people pillar and not in the processes pillar because tools are not an end in themselves. And the objective of having the right sales tools is to ensure that they enable sales. Then very often a lot of, you know, traditional sales people and sales teams or sales managers have used tools as a control mechanism, but that's moved on. Nowadays, you have enough sales tools available which can really be enablers of sales rather than controllers. having the right set of incentives is a no-brainer. But your sales teams need to, sales is no longer an individual sport. It is a team sport. And when I say team sport, it's not just a sales team's responsibility, but also how the rest of the organization works with the sales team in making the sales happen. Commercial, product management, marketing, HR, delivery, all of them. How do they come in the process of selling? And that leads me to my last bit, which is a thought that I want to leave with you. Over my years of experience of working with customers and sales teams, the frustration that most sales teams have is that customers see them as a vendor or a supplier, which means that the nature of relationship is really more transactional. And this is frustrating for people who have spent years in sales building relationships with customers. And there was a time when relationship was considered as the be-all and end-all of selling. If you have a great relationship, you will achieve your sales targets and you will meet your goals. But times have changed, and especially remote working, multiple people being involved in the buying side from the customer side has meant that along with relationship, you also need to be able to add business value. And while everybody aspires to be a business partner, but even if you were to get to a place of being a trusted advisor for your customers, then you've got to balance the kind of relationship that you have with your customer, co-create, co-build, collaborate, versus the kind of value that you create for them. Are you simply fulfilling their requirements, or are you doing something which is helping your customers become more competitive and successful in their own businesses? This is a two-way journey. Merely by the selling team wanting to be able to strategically solve customer problems, customers are not going to allow you to do that. They're not going to share their problems with you. And that requires you to build trust and relationship. And it's a step-by-step approach. So it's an iterative approach where relationship leads to value creation. Value creation further strengthens relationship, so on and so forth. But that's a model which really will take any sales team very far, and much more so if you are an interesting, innovative startup ready to conquer the world. That's really it from me on this short presentation. I hope you find it useful. If you have any questions, feel like reaching out to me. That's my business card. I've left it here for you. Feel free to contact me. Feel free to reach out to me. And all the best. And I hope you have a great 2 days at the Global Capital Summit session. Bye-bye.